Good afternoon. Good afternoon. Welcome. Welcome to the Thanksgiving of Joyce. I'm actually Alison Kitchener, and I come from Newington Free Church, which we were hoping to have the Thanksgiving service there, as it's just round the corner, but we thought there'd be so many people, and it's lovely to see so many people. So please feel welcome and feel the warmth of this place this afternoon. Global Crossfire, which Joyce and Judy come to this church, and you'll be meeting Benjamin soon, also used Newington Free Church, and I know Joyce loved it there, and we have a baptistry, which they haven't here, so every year we have fond memories of them coming to the baptistry and Joyce actually baptising people in the baptistry, which is just after surgery. That sounds like Joyce, doesn't it? So praise God for those people. And you will know that Joyce also worked in Sierra Leone, which is in West Africa. And this week I hear that they are celebrating the end of Ebola crisis there, which is great. Absolutely great. Joyce would have loved that. And in your packs, you will see that you have some leaflets about Missionary Aviation Fellowship. This is one of the charities that Joyce loved because they send little planes up and down countries. In fact, they've got 130 little planes that go to 25 developing countries. And they're called Flying for Life because they help. In fact, they're like Jesus planes, saving lives and bringing life. And although they're not in Sierra Leone yet, they are in Liberia. And one of the missionaries there, Hudson Taylor, said, "I have found that there are three stages in every great work of God. The first, it is impossible. And then the next, it is difficult. And the next, it is done." It is done. Three great works. As you ponder this, pray that this will prove true with the work of Missionary Aviation Fellowship. So if you can put some money in, then please do. You will find gift aid forms in there. So please do that if you can. But be blessed. Joyce is in a better place now, and we can praise God together that she has been our friend. So I pass over to Benjamin.
All right, I just want to say good afternoon. My name is Benjamin Ashon. I'm the resident pastor of Global Crossfire Church UK, Ramsgate branch, which Joyce happened to be a deacon in the church. She's a friend and a mother to me. And I remember the first time I met her, I just can't believe it. The joy around her was wonderful, and I wanted to have her close to me every time. And I thank God for her life. I want to welcome all of you here today. Some of you might have come from far countries and far places. And we are even blessed to have our general overseer here, Reverend Coach Odium. He'll be ministering the word of God to us. Let's put our hands together for him, please. Yeah, he said he wanted to be part of the program. He flew from the state right here yesterday night. And he wanted to go back tomorrow morning, but we're just going to keep him around a bit. So we thank God for, and all of you who have traveled from afar, close by, we thank God for your life and for you to be gathered here. We want to remember Joyce's family, particularly in Canada, who were unable to attend this meeting, his brother Charles and family, and his younger brother Alad and his family, Alice and family in New Zealand. And we remember friends and family in Ireland, and all of you gathered here. Her best friend, Miriam, and friends around the world. And some of them might have, I think we have recording here. They might be listening to it on Skype. So a lot of them wanted to be here, but they couldn't make it because of other circumstances. Okay? So we are happy you are here. Shall we be upstanding? Let's pray. We pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we just want to bless you for set a time as this. And I just want to thank you for the divine encounter that you've caused us to have fellowship with your gift that you give unto the body of Christ. We thank you for the life of Joyce in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you, God, for our encounter with this gift. And we always remember this gift, oh God. And we thank you, oh God, for what you've done. We just want to remember all gathered here. And I just want to thank you, oh God, for their life. And we thank you as we are about to celebrate the gift you've given unto us. We just want to thank you. And we just want to also take the opportunity to pray for our dear friend, Mother Joyce. And we thank you for her life. We also want to pray for Judy. And we thank you, oh God, for her life. And having gone through this time of difficulty, we thank you, God, that your sustaining grace has been available unto her beyond our imagination and beyond our belief, because you've done exceedingly abundantly above all we can think or even imagine. We lift up Lad and the family, Alice and the family, and all who have gathered here and all who are listening around the world. We thank you, God, for such a time as this. We bless you. We give you praise. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Shall we be seated? There's one hymn that we really want to sing here. We can't afford not to sing it. It means so much to Joyce. And we want to do the hymn, "Be Still for the Presence of the Lord." Bible reading. I want to invite our brother David Harker to do the reading. He's going to do the reading from Joyce's favorite Bible, the oldest one.
This reading is taken from the Bible that Joyce took with her all around the world. The first reading is taken, as I said, from Hebrews 13, verse 5b chapter 6, and was very important to Joyce, as she'll hear later. God has said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee, so that we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper, and I will not fear what man shall do unto me. The second reading is from 2 Timothy 4, verse 7 and 8, which, as written by the missionary St. Paul to a young pastor at the end of Paul's life. So 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7 to 8. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the course. I have kept the faith. In the future, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to who have loved his appearing.
David doesn't know this is going to happen, so it's a shock to him. Forgive him if he faints. David, I'm passing Joyce's Bible to you. I want you to have it. Sorry, I'll get over it. Some time ago, Pastor was talking in this church about passing on the baton. Pastor calls it the baton. The rest of it would call us the baton. But he says baton. Being good at French, he says baton. Anyway, this is the baton. David, Joyce has been in the relay race. She loved you as a son. Sorry, Carol, that's his mother. She loved you as a son, as you know. She's passing you. This is a symbol of the baton passing to you for you to keep and to run with it through your generation. And I've got a verse. I know you've got an e-Bible. Don't tell me you've got an e-Bible. I don't want to know. This is the verse for David. And it comes from Acts 13, verse 36. For David, after he had served the Lord in his own generation by the will of God, died. So David, until you die, run the race. Here's the baton. You go with it, boy. Run the race, fight the fight. And you're a representative of all the young people we've got here today. You are the generation. Archie Joyce has done a bit. God dropped out of the race. And you ran with her for a little while in that box in the relay. And now you take it over and run with it, boy. Thank you. I'll just carry on. So we've got a slideshow. Sadly, none of Joyce's family, here we see them. They live in Canada. Hey! That's her mum who's died. That's her older brother on the left and a younger brother on the right. She just had two brothers. You'll hear more about them as we go through the story. Her mum passed away, and so it's just the two boys left and their families. Hello to you in Canada. Nice to see you. think about you. So her Dutch family, they wanted to come, but they couldn't make it. One's a teacher, so Pastor knows what that's like. He couldn't leave the school to come. He wanted to come. So they did want to be here, but they just couldn't make it. But never mind. We've got our spiritual family here, and that's the most important. But they will be making DVDs. Paul here, very helpful. If Paul comes and asks you to say something, please comply and help with the DVD. I'm so grateful to Coach that he's come from the United States just for this service. We've clapped him already, but I'm very grateful, Coach, for coming. Pastor Mary, where is she? She's always off the scene when you want to thank her. Mary! Please come into this church now. She's always away. She's never in any photos. She's never in any videos. Mary, come here and let me say thank you. She's done. They came to me, 20 people. Okay. 20 of them came to my house. They decamped the meeting to my house. They came in and they said, we'll do everything. We'll do the floral displays, we'll do the food, we'll do the stationery, we'll do everything, and we'll pay for it. Right. What sort of church is that?
Wait a minute.
You've got to come here. I know what you're like. She's always unassuming and out of the way. But I thank you, Mary, and thank you, Pastor, and thank you to all the brothers and sisters who've really, they set up little committees in every place, and it's gone wonderfully. Thank you for everything. Love you. Amazing woman, amazing woman. Right, now we come to the main issue. I was thinking about it, and I just thought about it. You've all known Joyce in little bits, and today I'm going to put it all together so that all the pieces of the jigsaw come to make one whole. So some will know her from work, some will know her from the church, blah, blah. That's Mary's favourite saying, blah, blah, blah. This picture was at a surprise birthday party which she had when she was 50 years old. She came up the stairs in Elim, the Oasis, the former church, and she was so surprised. The people had come from London, like Jean has today, and they came to see her on her birthday, and here she is. Oh, and she'd be just like that if she saw you here today. Do that many people know me? Do that many people care? There she was. So, there. Is there anyone among us who's lived, and please put your hand up, in three continents, four countries, and over 20 towns and villages? Can you fulfill that job description? Some of you are widely travelled and have lived in many places. Nobody. See, Joyce lived in three continents, four countries, and 20 places. She was in a remote village in the middle of Sierra Leone in Africa. She lived in Rotterdam. She lived in Vancouver. She lived in London, which was where I met her, as you'll hear. So how can such a life be contained in a few minutes? Not that long ago, Prim, we went to St. Mark's Church and we just talked about the war, and that took 30 minutes. So I could keep you here for hours and hours talking stories about Joyce, and I'm sure in the future I'll regale you with many more. The people who've come to the house are sick to death of my story. Poor Joe's heard the same stories over and over and over again, but it's helped me to think about her and think of the stories. She's got some wonderful stories. How can such a life be reduced to a few minutes? And I'm stealing from Coach's sermon because I'm taking the time up. Anybody care about the time? Good. I don't. So, Joyce, let's start with the poor girl. Born in 20th of the September, 1940. Here she is at about four, I think, just after the war. Little chubby cheeks. She had a very eventful beginning, as the St. Mark's ladies know. Her father was in the Dutch resistance. They were helping Jews. We've got some Jewish friends here today, and we love very much. Her father was helping Jews in the Dutch resistance. And he was in a cell group where they, you know, those were in the resistance. And one of the cell group was arrested and tortured, gave the names of all the others away. So her father, in the middle of the night, put her and her mum on one bike, it's Holland, don't forget, and the other one, her brother and her father. They didn't dare go in the car. They left everything behind. They just took a few things on the bike, and they cycled for miles and miles to where there was a sympathetic farmer, and he let them stay in a haystack. Now, Dutch haystacks, Tony know about Dutch haystacks? Dutch haystacks are not like English haystacks. There's a kind of space at the top. It's not like our sort of haystack. It's sort of room at the top. Above the animals, there's the hay and then the room. And they stayed in that room for 18 months. And she was terrified. The Germans would come to get milk and cheese and things, and her parents would say, shh, don't, nothing, don't, because she was a chatty little thing. And her parents said, shh, nothing, nothing. And she was very afraid for many years afterwards. So that was an amazing beginning. The good thing was, and there was a good thing, she got food. The rest of Holland was hungry, but they had food because they were on a farm. And she was dressed like a farm child, and she ran about. I'm sure she enjoyed it immensely when it was safe. You know, it was awful. She told me of the liberation and being given sweets by, I believe it was Americans, but I might be wrong. Joe says it may have been British. I don't know who liberated Holland. Somebody will put my history right. But whoever liberated her, them, gave her sweets, and she'd never had sweets before in her life. So here we see her with pigtails, probably about 9, I would think. Big brother. Hello, Charlie. We've shown a picture of you at the moment. Next one. Now Allard, the youngest brother, is born. He was 8 years younger than her, so I think she's probably about 12 at that time. As with most Dutch, her father, who had previously owned a very thriving business, was bankrupted. He had nothing, and he decided to take the family to Canada and start all over again. Joyce finished her education, in which she excelled. You might guess she'd excel at anything that good. She spoke 4 languages. She played many instruments, especially the organ, piano, violin, and lots. And she loved maths, which I absolutely hate. She wanted to remain in Holland, but Dad wanted her in Canada, so she reluctantly, she's told me she cried all the journey. She had to emigrate to Canada because her father wanted her there. That's a picture of her. I believe it's the emigration picture that somebody snapped. She looks quite cheerful there, but she was sad having to go to Canada from Holland. She became a teacher in Canada, and she taught primary. Now we get to the children. She loved teaching primary. And you can imagine she'd be very good with children, especially the discipline. She used to tell me these wonderful stories about identical twins who'd say, "It's not me, miss, it's him." And the other one would say, "It's not me, miss, it's him." Their names were Tommy and Timmy. In the end, she got so fed up with them, she brought them both out and disciplined them both, I suspect with a smack, and said, "I don't care which one of you it is, you both get a smack," and they never did it again. I don't think Tommy, and I can't see any identical, Joe's the expert on identical twins, so I don't think they're there in that particular slide. So that's Tommy and Timmy. After teaching maths to secondary, she went from primary to secondary, and she taught maths like our pastor does. She got a bit disheartened with it because children, just not always children, like maths. So she said, "I'm going to go back to Holland." She loved Holland. Holland was her roots. "I'll go back to Holland and I'm going to be a nurse." So now we go to Holland. Here she is doing the obstetric part of her course. It's important to note she didn't do midwifery full. She did 6 months obstetrics. Here she is with the babies, all the little babies. She's in the middle, as you know. She really enjoyed her nurse training. She enjoyed it very much. She soon, of course, became a night sister in charge of the whole place, you know, you can imagine it. It was during this time that Joyce, who'd been a religious person all her life, who'd known God as a remote person, you know, remote entity, "There's God out there, I'm here, I love God." I'm sure at that time she said to me, "Yeah, if anybody said you love God," she'd say yes. But she went to a new church, and in that church they told her that God wasn't just out there, he loved her. She said to me, "I realised that God loved me so much that he sent Jesus to die on the cross for my sins." This applies to all of us. And he loves us, but she realised he loved her. And she said, "I want to give my life to you. I'll give my life to you, Jesus. Thank you for dying for me." And she was about 19. She'd had some, no, maybe a little older. She'd had some hard times in Canada, and she was needy, and she gave her whole life to Jesus at that time. She decided then she'd become a missionary. She felt God was saying, "Come and work for me. I'm your boss now, work for me." And she agreed. She had a blissfully happy year in Cape and Ray Bible College. She absolutely loved Bible College. She said she used to sit in the lectures and the tears would roll down her face. She was felt so touched. Anybody know Cape and Ray? A Bible College, missionary training college, and she loved it. At the end of the year, now we're coming to Sierra Leone. At the end of the year, she wasn't sure where the Lord wanted to send her. She was willing to go anywhere. She said, "I'll go anywhere, Lord, show me." So she joined the European Baptist Mission, and they said they needed a person in Sierra Leone. She had no idea where it was. She had to get a map to see where it was. She's told me, she said, "I didn't know where." Does anybody know where it's on the west coast of Africa? We've got plenty of people from Sierra Leone here who will describe it accurately to you. They told her that it was to run mobile clinics, to set up mobile clinics and also preach Jesus. Well, obviously, we'll come to that in a minute. So off she went. One day she felt absolutely helpless. She told me she was thinking about she was going to be on her own in the middle of a jungle. There'd be nobody really about, and she was quite afraid. And she said she knelt down by her bed. Some of you have heard this story. She knelt down by her bed and she said, "Lord Jesus, I'm going to work for you. You're my boss. I'm working for you. Please give me power, power." And the Holy Spirit, those of you who know about it, the Holy Spirit came upon her in great measure. She said that she used to tell me a lot. She said that it was a fire. It was like a fire. I said, "Weren't you afraid?" Because I'm a pyrophobic. I'm terrified of fire. And she said there was a fire in the room and it just kept roaring and roaring and roaring. And she felt so full of power. And so off she went in this new power to Sierra Leone. Here she is in the Land Rover. She would take nationals who could preach the gospel, because it was Timni, those of you who are from Sierra Leone, it was Timni tribes who spoke Timni, so she couldn't speak the language. So she'd take a local pastor, that's probably behind there, the pastor, and in the Land Rover. And off they would go for 18-hour days in very dangerous terrain, very dangerous. Those of you who come from Sierra Leone know what the roads are like. And she said they carried planks in, this is just Joyce, they carried planks in the back of the truck. And if they came to a river, no bridge, they just put these two planks over the bridge, over to make a bridge. She said she would put the wheels of the Land Rover, and I believe it, put the wheels of the Land Rover on these two planks and just pray like mad and drive. Sometimes she shut her eyes and just go over this roaring torrent underneath. And I said, "Well, weren't you afraid?" She said, "No, the Lord was with me, and the Lord was so close to me." The poor man who was with her was a Muslim. He was crying to Allah all the time. She's praying to God. Mr. Siddiqui, she loved Mr. Siddiqui very, very much. There's a picture now. They were digging wells. Well, she wasn't personally, but she was teaching them to dig wells, build toilets, amazing things. This is the children who sort of would greet her every day. She would do 18 hours of medical work under a tree. This is significant for later. Under a tree, she would just set up a clinic. They'd do all the medicine. She'd like a doctor, wasn't she, Joe? A doctor in the jungle. We heard that often enough. I was a doctor in Sierra. Yes, Joyce. Most of all, she would usually have a young pastor with her who would preach. One day, 40 people said they'd like to follow Jesus, so she was very happy. This is a letter I just found from her just after she got there, and she said this. This is the sort of conditions there were. I'm not saying it's Sierra Leone today, but at that time. 3 weeks ago, I spoke with a still relatively young woman from this area, it's the Timni tribe area, who told us that she'd borne 9 children and not one was alive. She said in this letter, "I felt so sad, but what did the mother feel like?" She had 9 children, none of them surviving. So that was what the background of what she was working with. And I'm sure it's improved somewhat today, but that was some years ago, obviously. So we're coming to Sierra Leone now. It was so wonderful that when we came to this church, Cuddy, it was so wonderful that when we came to this church, we found a group of Sierra Leoneans, and she was so happy to have about 10 who come from Sierra Leone. This is Cuddy, great friend of ours. She's the secretary of the church, and she said to me, "Can I say a little bit for Auntie Joyce?"
Hello, everyone. My name is Cuddy, and I'm a Sierra Leonean by nationality. It is with great pleasure, on behalf of all the Sierra Leoneans here, that we had the opportunity and privilege to get to meet Deaconess Joyce before she departed from us. We thank her for all her medical and missionary work that she did back home in Sierra Leone. Not many people could sacrifice to do such. So we have missed her, we loved her, and we pray that she rests in the arms of the Lord. We always miss her. Thank you all.
No, get the others up.
Yeah. We want to welcome all the Sierra Leoneans just to sing a song. Yeah, the song is titled Osho Osh, just sympathizing with the families, just that it's a difficult time to go through, but they just have to bear it. With God's help and support, they'll get through it by God's grace. Amen.
Amen. Osho, 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 yeah, we know say Monana for be a ransom. Osho, Judy, Osho, yeah, we know say Monana for be a ransom. Charles, Osho, Osho, yeah. We no say monana for be a ransom. Alad Osho, 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 yeah. We no say monana for be a ransom. Global Cross Crossfire, Osho, Osho, yeah. We no say monana for be a ransom. Newton. Church, Osho, 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 yeah. We no say monana for be a ransom. Friends, Osho,
Osho, Osho, yeah. We no say.
They gave me a band that's actually come from Sierra Leone, and it's got the colours of the national flag. So there's three of those, and it's on the flowers. It actually came from Sierra Leone, and Joyce will be so happy with it. So I'll put it back on the flower. Joyce had a boat, so when she couldn't go by this jolly Land Rover, she went by boat, a very inadequate boat, I might add. And she put the staff, who couldn't swim, she told me, and supplies on this boat. And one day, the blinking boat sank. Good job, she was a lifeguard. She had to rescue the staff and try and rescue the supplies into a huge river. They're not sort of little rivers that go up the middle of the Thames or something. Huge rivers in Sierra Leone, big ones. And the boat sank. They all got out, even though they couldn't swim. Somehow she got them out. Only Joyce could do that. And the Joyce was rather redundant. She could neither go by the van, the mobile lorry, you know, thing, or the boat. So the mission said to her, what do you want to do? She said, I've just delivered a baby that was a breech the wrong way up, and the baby died. And she said, it broke my heart. She was doing deliveries as well. And she said, I'd like to go to learn about midwifery. And so this is when I come in. Because I, in foolishness, was a tutor. This is the hospital where we were. This is where we met. And Jean, no, they've raised it to the ground. Shame on them, shame on them. They've raised it. How could they with memories of Joyce? They've still got the colonnade, Jean.
No, what they've done is they've made it into
a housing estate.
Okay, where we had the colonnade, they split it up to the theatre and the baby's unit is still there.
Yeah, I've seen the colonnade.
Going right through. The front of the hospital is still there.
Yeah, this?
Yeah.
Good.
It's a listed building.
Listed building, so it should be when Joyce was there.
I was born there.
You were born there, many people were. It was a Salvation Army hospital, that's why the mission chose it. They said, we'll look for a Christian hospital for you. It was Salvation Army, and I was working there as a tutor. I'd been started there when I'd started in Bournemouth, in where these good people have come from. I trained in Poole Hospital and went to London for the midwifery, stayed on there, and I was a tutor. You imagine the job I had teaching that one. My first experience with Joyce was she was crying in the baby nursery. And I went in, she was a new student, I was a tutor, and I said, student midwife Van Veen, we were formal in those days, I said to her, whatever's the matter? And the tears were rolling down her cheeks. And she said, here, I'm throwing milk away. You know, we had those bottles and they just drank a little bit and the rest was thrown. She said, in Africa, they're desperate for this sort of milk, for the mums who can't breastfeed very well. We want milk. And here I am throwing it away. And the tears were rolling down her cheeks. She loved Sierra Leone till the day she died. And I began to talk to her about Sierra Leone and she started to tell me, and don't take the baby out. She loved babies. Please don't take the baby out. Please don't take the baby home. She loves babies. She's not, it's wonderful. So that was my first experience. There are all sorts of mischievous tales I might tell you about it, but I won't bore you. She passed her exams. I was greatly saddened to say goodbye because now this good friend I'd now made, prayed with, went to the same church with where we met Jean, who's over there, as well as the mother. Was going to go to Sierra Leone, so I was very, very sad. I say goodbye through the, I can feel it now, say goodbye through the barrier. Bye, Joyce. And I'll come and see you. I said, I'll come and see you. I'm coming. I'll get the ticket. I'll go and buy the ticket from the airport. She wrote to me many times. She sent, in those days, she made a tape. All I could hear on this blooming tape is rain pouring down onto a tin roof in Freetown or something. All I heard was patter, 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 monsoon rains or whatever in Sierra Leone, I don't know. But I heard her voice. We tried to telephone. I go, hello, 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 all around the world. Hello, hello, hello. Judy, are you there? Judy, are you? It was ridiculous, so we didn't do very well. But she wrote many letters and they'll be a joy to me in the coming days when I get them out and have a nice read. I was just going to go over to see her. I hadn't quite bought the ticket when I heard from the mission that she was extremely ill, very, very ill indeed. She had something called endocarditis. She was extremely ill. They brought her back to Holland. So I got on a plane. I quickly went to Holland, accidentally stayed in the red light district because it was cheap. I said to her when I did see her, I said, Joyce, I'm staying in such and such place. She looked aghast. She said, that's the red light district. I said, I wanted a cheap hotel. She got better quick to come and look after me. She was skinny. She looked so ill. She'd been through so much and they'd flown her home. I thought she was going to go. I thought she was going to die at that time. And she was very, very ill. But unfortunately, she couldn't go back to Sierra Leone. She never got over it. She always said, oh, why didn't the Lord get me go back? I said, well, you weren't well. You were half dead, woman, and I needed you. I didn't tell her that, but that was what it was. Anyway, so she didn't have much family, so I said, stay with me. Here I'm as a tutor in the green, and there she is a student, or maybe just passed. And we had a flat in London. Joyce Jean was a nearby neighbour. And we were happy in the London. And she joined the London Hospital. Lovely uniform. She loved that uniform. She'd wear all the tails. The Queen came, and she wore all the tails and the white buffs, and she just loved that uniform. She became a sister there. She became a community midwife. She's always shot to the top of everything she ever did. And we were happy. We had a church there. We loved the church. We went and did old people's work, blah, blah, blah. As Mary would say, blah, blah, blah. It can't go into it all. One day, Joyce showed me a small black area on her foot. And I said, oh, it doesn't look very good, Joyce. She had a bad skin and she was going to the dermatologist anyway. And I said, when you go to the dermatologist, show the dermatologist that skin. It doesn't look good to me. It looks nasty. Not so much publicity about melanoma in those days. I remember it so clearly. And one Friday night, she got a phone call from the doctor to her, and she came home and told me, she said, Judy, she said, it's a highly malignant melanoma. Oh, my my heart went in my mouth. I said, oh no. Because she'd been in the sun and nothing protected her feet. Of course, she had her head protected and her body bit protected and under the trees. Her feet became under the sun, a lot of sun. She got a melanoma. Oh, it was dreadful. Now comes the what reason why she loved, I will never leave you nor forsake you. In short, she got three times from the Lord that verse, doesn't matter about how, but three times in that weekend, I, Lord, will never leave you nor forsake you. Became a favourite verse. On the Sunday, I was so upset. I was looking for secondaries, you know, those of us who are nurses. I was looking all over saying, oh, golly, maybe it's spread. I was in a terrible state. She said, it's all right. The Lord has shown me you're never going to leave me. I will not fear what man do unto me. She was going to go for surgery. And on the Sunday, she was prayed for in the church, just a little church like ours, an ordinary pastor and a black deacon and a white deacon. And they came up and they prayed for her. And she was healed. She was healed. She never had any malignant cells again. She was absolutely healed. On the Monday, we went to the surgeon. It was a plastic surgeon. His name was Mr. Hackett. Wouldn't you change your name if your name was Mr. Hackett? A plastic surgeon called Mr. Hackett. And if we weren't so upset, if I wasn't so uptight, I'd have laughed. But I wasn't up to laughing. And she said to him, I'm healed. He said, yes, yes. Let's be on the safe side and take it and deal with it. So she said, well, if you insist, but I'm healed. I know I'm healed. So to cut a long story short, he did do the surgery, but he never found one malignant cell. I went to the follow-up appointment with the doctor, and he said to me, he looked at her very sheepishly, and he said, not one malignant cell was in what we took away. That was the Lord's. It was the Lord's glory. We were 23 years, oh, I haven't come to that yet. The mother's hospital sadly closed. So we fought it, didn't we, Jean? We tried, but we didn't win. So we prayed to ask for a change of location, and we both got jobs in. Now we come to Thanet. Nearly there, you're nearly finished. It was amazing. They took her on as a health visitor. She had a history of recent cancer and all sorts of other problems. Anyway, they took her on. And I'm so pleased to see her colleagues here today. Thank you for coming. She loved the work, and she loved being with you all. We were 23 years working in a local church. Now, some of you will recognize these people. There's Julie. There's the children from that time. Kerry, all sorts of people you might recognize. Next one, please. That one even more. There's Viv pre-Rob. This is Viv before Rob came on the scene. Remember that, Viv? That's Viv pre-Rob. She had a lodger and married him. Yes, wonderful. There's Byron, there's James, there's Kerry again, and all the people you know. Carol Stark from Mandy and so on. And next one. And this, I love this one because a man came to speak one day and he had a bicycle hearse, motorbike, and he had a hearse. Joyce would have loved that. I should have done it today. I have a motorbike hearse. So this is a little bit later. Look at the young David. Ooh, spiritual son. And now Rob's on the scene. There's Viv peeping behind my mother. We had a very happy time, 23 years in that church. And I've got a special saying. Joyce had nearly as many pastors as the Queen had prime ministers. It's lovely to see Ken. Thank you, Ken. Lovely to see you. The blandishments were wonderful, yes. Absolutely, brother. We got great memories of the pastors. The photo on the front of the sheet was one Sunday service when snow was on the ground and we walked to church. I love this photo. We were walking to that church, in the grounds of that church, and it was snowing, so the friend just took a photo. It's not a terribly good, clear photo, and they moan about it, say it's not clear. I said, I don't care, it's the one I love. She retired from work in 2000 and began to be committed to the fostering support groups. Where's the fostering carers? Where are you? Where's Nora? Yeah, they're there. Yeah, thank you for coming as well. So she began to still, she was still involved in children's work. She loved it. That's why I don't want the baby out. 3 years ago, we moved to this church family and immediately had a... we brought with us, my mother died, we brought with us a funeral. I haven't got pictures for you. And a wedding of our spiritual children, who are also here today, Anna and Mohit. Now, Anna did not marry Nikki. It looks like it, but that's her son. Anna married Mohit, and Mohit is nowhere on the picture to be seen. I don't know where he was. That was the wedding. We brought with us poor pastor. I said to him, I'm coming to your church, so I'm bringing a funeral and I'm bringing a wedding. He said, all right, didn't you? He was very gracious. Joyce fell and had a very bad break of her leg. There you can see she had a wheelchair. And she hated the wheelchair. Oh, of course. And then September the 20th, I'm so happy this year, September the 20th, she had a birthday, 75th. Look at her face. She's so happy to have a birthday cake in this church. Not anywhere near Mandy's. This is a bought one. It's not a patch on Mandy's cakes. But there we are, Joycey with her birthday cake. And I'm so happy because they videoed it. I don't know who videoed it. Somebody, pastor videoed it. And he's given me the video and I've got a moving image of my 38-year heart friend. So I'm very happy. She was more and more in pain. Although she looks cheerful there, she was in lot pain. And got worse. And she got a staphylococcal skin infection and got very ill. I didn't expect her to die, but she did die in hospital. They rang me up and said she had a cardiac arrest, and she went home to be with Jesus on the 5th of November. She went out with a bang. Trust her to go out with a bang. I'm nearly there. I want to do an acrostic of her name, for those of you who didn't know her very well, about some of her characteristics. So we'll start with Joyce, my choice. The E, she was enthusiastic. Joyce was enthusiastic about so much. Of course, her faith, her family, her spiritual family, Sierra Leone, all of that work. But she lots of other things. She loved the organ, piano. This is here in a group early on with a violin. And she loved singing. She was in a choir with Poppy, who's here today. They loved to sing. So, and Poppy and Steve and her husband are here today. So, music. She loved nature. This is where I might cry. She loved everything in nature. We had cats together. We had cats. I knew this would be it. This happened in my mother's funeral. I was dry-eyed about my mother. When I got to the dog died, I started to cry. And I'm doing it again with a cat. Sick. Anyway, the cat died just after Joyce and was buried in the coffin with her. So I said goodbye to two of my best mates today. Not that cat, that one had already died, but another black cat, nearly 24 years of age, which was good age. But she loved Joyce, and Joyce loved her, and they're in the coffin together at this moment. Dear, oh dear. Even a fish is laying down and dying this very day. The fish is belly up in the pond. I said, don't do this to me. Don't do it. Travel. She loved travel. She loved travel and seeing beautiful places. Here we are in Alaska in a glacier. We loved the glacier. We went on a cruise and saw a glacier. Joe, Joyce and I went to Israel and how we loved Israel to walk where Jesus had walked. And she wanted to go there again. She sadly hasn't yet. Reading and puzzling, everybody knows her with this one. Spider solitaire and the occasional Candy Crush. On the MBNA, on the bill would come Candy Crush or something like that and an amount. I said, what have you been doing? She said, I didn't do it. I said, well, I haven't. How's it got on the bill? Candy Crush, just occasionally Candy Crush. She loved it. Although she wouldn't own up to it. Food. She loved food. And Jan and Tony, where are they? Jan and Tony, yeah, gave her a last herring. I was so happy that she had that herring before she got sick. This is a previous time, but she, you know, they eat them like this. It's very indiscreet. I hate them. I think they're filthy. They're not cooked. They're just, oh, she loved it. Thank you, Jan and Tony, for giving her a last herring. She loved cars. Oh, crazy about cars. That's her first. I think that's her first. And she hated it when I drove. I always felt I was having a driving test every day of my life. Stop there. Go there. Move over. You go faster. It was either a driving instructor or a driving test every single day. And it was awful. But she loved cars. She hated it when I drove. And lastly, she liked sports. She was a lifeguard, as I said before, a keen sailor. She liked golf. Next one up, please, David. Calm. Joyce was calm where I was excited. Ball. And the particular example was, we had a fire. This is the very oven where we had the blinking fire. The flames were leaping up. When I say, I know I'm given to exaggeration. Those who know me know I'm given to exaggeration. But in this instance, I'm not. The flames were leaping up out of that hob there. The hob was on with the gas and we couldn't turn it off. And the flames were leaping up. I was in the street shouting, fire, fire. Joyce, pouring water on it, probably that kettle from behind. Water, water. I said, get out. All the adverts say, get out, get out. No. Pouring. And I'm screaming. The fire engine draws up. I'm screaming, fire, fire in there. They said, the fire's out. Your friends put the your friends put the fire out. It's a classic example of what happened to her. So she was always calm. Ivan knows how hopeless I am if anything comes in the house. We had the cat, the current cat that's still alive, brought in a big pigeon. How he got it through the cat flap, I don't know. A big pigeon, and I come downstairs and there's this pigeon flapping and the cat going mad. And I scream in, and poor Joyce is in bed upstairs. Joyce! Joyce! There's a bird! Socks has brought in a bird! Help! Poor thing. She struggled out of bed. She struggled downstairs with a crutch. She gently bent down. She couldn't get down. Bent down. Put her hands, Dino, as Dino does it. As a Dino type bird. Put her hands around the bird. She struggled through the room, through the conservatory. I opened the door. She went, and off it flew. It was perfectly all right. Wonder it was. Didn't die of fright with that socks looking at her. But it was fine. And I'll tell you the end of the story now. Why? He was young at heart. She took me to things I would never have dreamed of. I'd only travelled 100 miles up the road. She took me to white water rafting in Slovenia. I can still feel it. I was terrified. She was so happy and I was terrified, hanging on to the side of the boat. She, it's wonderful. hugging dolphins. Look at that. Look at that. Hugging dolphins. Beautiful dolphins. The other picture with me is, and she's, beautiful. She loved dolphins. Through the Rocky Mountains, on a gondola in Venice, all the things you do, you know, just as you do. Under the Niagara in a Maid of the Mist. Joyce Winwell was full of fun. On the service sheet is a picture of what Joyce gave her mum, marshmallow false teeth for Christmas. You see a picture on the last but one page where she's got, she and her mum, and her mum, they're having a huge laugh about marshmallow false teeth. Typical Joyce, young at heart. Oh, open-handed. I know there are many here today who can bear testimony to the fact that Joyce was extremely generous. Just a few weeks ago, Jimmy, just there, had his bike stolen from there. Joyce took him straight home, didn't she, Jimmy? She said, have this bike. It was her bike, she could do it, it wasn't mine. She said to Jimmy, have this bike. So Jimmy's riding Joyce's bike. She, and her emphasis is on she, yeah, Jimmy. She opened our home to friends. Dino from Cyprus, Ivan from Bulgaria, best country in the world. That's all I heard, Bulgaria, wonderful country. And Kingsley from Botswana. Kingsley today sent a message. He said, and it's a little rude, Joyce kicked me in the butt and you consoled me. And it pretty well sums up our whole lives. She would tell him off and I would go behind and say, it's all right. And he said to me, I needed both. I needed the kick and I needed the consolation. And the kick is, he's in Canada now doing nursing and he's doing well. And he needed that kick and he needed the consolation. Talk about Arsenal and all sorts. So open-handed. hard-handed. She loved math, we've heard that already, and the donations are going to go to math. Last one, and I mean the last, and I'm not going to last like some people who say this is the last point, it lasts. Jesus-centered. As I told you, about 19, Joyce made a choice. That she would follow Jesus. She got out of the driving seat of her car and let Jesus in. And he led, guided, kept, healed, as we've heard, delivered, taken her home to be with himself. Her whole life, Jesus was in the driving seat of her life. And I'm so proud of her for that. She did make bad choices in her life. She would be only too willing to accept that. But she never, ever, ever regretted the choice to follow Jesus wholeheartedly. And I know she would want you to make the same choice, and she would wanted me to tell you that today. Choose Jesus and follow him. Recently, Joyce said, I want to go home. And like the bird in our house, the Lord showed me, he said, you remember how she got the bird 2-3 weeks ago? She's come to the door of the end of her life, and now she's gone. And Melissa's going to sing a song next about soaring. And so when I hear Melissa sing about soaring, that's what Joyce has done. She's come to the end of life, and she's soaring to be with him. My life will never be the same. But that's this Thanksgiving service, I want to say a personal thank you for the gift she's been to me. On the back of the sheet, it quotes what Job said when his loved ones were gone. The Lord gave, the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And that's all I can say. Amen. Now, Poppy will read a poem. You need your tissues. I couldn't possibly read it, but Poppy can. Well done, Poppy. Thank you. I have finished. Sorry, it's a small problem.
Miss me, but let me go. When I come to the end of the road and the sun has set for me, I want no tears in a gloom-filled room. Why cry for a soul set free? Miss me a little, but not too much, and not with head bowed low. Remember the love that once we shared. Miss me, but let me go. This is a journey we all must take, and each must go alone. It's all part of God's perfect plan, a step on the road to home. When you are lonely and sick of heart, go to friends you know. Bury your sorrows in doing good. Miss me, but let me go.
All right. Thank you. Bless you.
Under your wings.
Standing, let's do "Great is Thy Faithfulness." Oh God, my Father. Who would like to do the first and last verses? Stanzas. Crossfire Church, Reverend Coach Odom, Welsh Shaker, shall we welcome him? Thank you.
I bring you greetings from Ghana, the Grobra Crossfire family, and from my own family. I was with my family in the U.S. and I had to interrupt my vacation and come here. Judy had tried to paint a picture in your minds, and I have the challenge to paint my own picture through the Word of God. At this time, I want to invite us to reflect on the faithfulness of God. I don't have space to talk about my relationship with Joyce, but let me just say one thing. She was one of those who encouraged me to write my first book on prayer. And it was something that she did forcefully. And now I can reflect and say that time was not on her side. Let your conversation be without covetousness and be content with such things as he have, for he had said, I'll never leave thee nor forsake thee. So that we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper, and I'll not fear what man shall do unto me. We are reflecting on the faithfulness of God. Troubles, hardships, problems, persecutions, illness, and other forms of difficulties are part of the issues we face in life. I was just reflecting that in the past, we'll spend Monday to Friday to work to find solutions. Now it is not enough. We work from Monday to Sunday trying to find solutions. People who have solutions are people who are giving us life. So solutions come because there are issues that each of us face. So these are part of the normal life. They come in different forms and times. And their impact could be devastating. And they can endure for a long or short period. In whatever way or form they come, one has to deal or cope with them or simply succumb to their impact. However, the strange thing is that although there might be supportive measures and people around us, the burden of the suffering is most borne directly by the person who is the target of the suffering. Friends and family may come near to show their sympathy, but just as in the case of Job, what can they really offer apart from being close to us in our suffering? I have reflected and concluded in agreement with history that people can do terrible things to one another because some of them become agents of evil or they agree to implement the wicked schemes of the enemy, whether in the church, in the office, in our homes or in the schools. The question is, who is bullying? Human beings making life difficult for the others. In the church, James says that the rich oppress the poor, even in the church. How much more in the world and people who don't know God, to whom they can cry for help in time of suffering or difficulty. A wise king called David gives us an insight into how wicked people or any person can be. He did something that God did not like. And God sent the prophet Gad to give a message to David. And the response of David to God was this. He said, I would rather fall into the hands of you, God, than to fall into the hands of a human being. So we create suffering and problems. We create difficulties for people. Ever since Satan was thrown on this earth with his entourage, manifestations of different types of woes have been the portion of mankind. However, apart from natural calamities and sufferings, believers have a special place in the heart of Satan. Satan and his angels target Christians and they unleash upon them vigorous attacks leading to various forms of suffering. And that is why the Lord says, that is the reason why the Lord says that he will never leave us nor forsake us. The Lord also tells us that he is our very present help in times of trouble. He also says that nothing can separate us from his love. When we pass through fire, he is with us. When we pass through the floods, he is with us. When in the office, in our homes, when we, any type of difficult situation we face, he says that he would be with us. Above all, he gives us a comforting, enduring assurance that he is our high priest, the one who is acquainted with our suffering. He knows our going out and he knows our coming in. He is our intercessor, the one who speaks on our behalf, the one who stands with us in times of suffering and difficulty. Sometimes I'm overwhelmed with the issues that confront people. So when that woman said she has suffered under the hands of many doctors over a period of time, it is true. But the bad thing is that some people don't know where to go when they are faced with suffering. They try to deal with their suffering. But there is a place. There is a person. There is a place. And there is a person. That is why Jesus said, "Come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." In Psalm 18, from verse 1 to verse 6, the psalmist paints a picture which I want to share with you. This psalmist calls the Lord his rock. He calls the Lord my fortress. And he calls the Lord my deliverer. He calls the Lord my strength. And he calls him my buckler. He also says that the Lord is his salvation and his strong tower. And look at what he said. He said, and I quote, "I will call upon the Lord who is worthy to be praised, so I shall be saved from my enemies. The sorrows of death compassed me." And this is what I like most. "And the flaws of ungodly men make me afraid. The sorrows of hell compass me about, and the snares of death prevented me. In my distress, I called upon the Lord and cried unto God. He heard my voice out of his temple, and my cry came before him, even into his ears." The Lord who created us gave us ears. And when we are in trouble, he opens his ears unto our cry. Unquote Psalm 18, 3-6. Peter simply says that we should cast our burden upon him because he cares. Do you have someone upon whom you can cast your burdens, Do you have a place where you can cast your burdens? But the question is, can we trust him that he will never leave us nor forsake us? Sure, he has a track record of being with those who trust him. In the literature out there, we know the story of Daniel and the three Hebrew boys. We know the story of Job. We know the story of the disciples. We know stories around where Jesus had intervened. The Lord has heard the cries of Auntie Joyce and saved her from her physical pain. She had a strong spirit, which always showed that she knew that the Lord would never leave her nor forsake her. For us who believe in him, he has also given us his own spirit, his Holy Spirit. He lives in us, he is with us, and he rests upon us. This is an enduring assurance of his ever presence with those who trust him. But to be able to trust someone, you want to make sure that that person is faithful. The Lord indeed is faithful. He had never forsaken those who put their trust in him in all generations and even the generations to come. And the Bible says that faithful is he that has called you, and he will do it. In Revelation 19 and 11, the Bible says that I saw heaven standing open, and there before me was a white horse, whose rider is called Faithful and True. Our Lord is faithful and true. Men might mean it, but they might not be able to do it. Ever since I came to know Auntie Joyce, and I came to understand her philosophy of life, and her philosophy was that she wanted to live knowing that however hard life will be for her, her Lord will be there for her. She lived a life of confidence, knowing that she can be content with an unswerving assurance that the Lord would not leave or forsake her. Her confidence was never in what any person can do for her or to her, but rather how God will show up when bricks and blocks are cast at her through her life. She now invites you to join her and walk in the path that she walked in this life by not letting your confidence be in yourself, which we call selfishness, self-centered, self-will, or in your achievement, your social status, or any qualifications that you have in life. Those things are not enduring. The great architectural buildings and monuments we find around, as we saw one, they will soon come down. But there is an enduring presence, an enduring place that will never crumble, crack, or be raised to the ground. Finally, she invites you to live a selfless life by casting your confidence in one who will never forsake you through thick and thin, as they say, and lead you eventually to heavenly shores, so your labor will not be in vain. Let's pray. Father, we just want to thank you for your word. Thank you for the restoration, the confidence. Thank you for the hearts that are yearning to move towards you right now. I just want to thank you for the release, the reconnection. Thank you for the assurance. Thank you that people would find a hiding place, that you be the rock, the tower. You would be the buckler. You would be the salvation. You become the song in the mouth of people. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
We're getting closer. We want to do In Christ Alone, My Hope Is Found. We'll do the first and the last. Shall we be outstanding, please? Whilst the man of God was preaching, there is somebody here, just to prove to you that God is real. You've got a cancer in your intestines. The Lord said, I'm healing you. I pray that God will perfect his healing in your body. I pray that God will perfect his healing in your body. I pray for all who have gathered here, sacrificing their time, their resources, that may the Lord bless you and favor you. As you've shown love to Joyce, I pray that may God show love to you. I pray for Charles and the family, Lord and the family, and all families, Alice and the family. Most especially, I pray for Judy, the God that will be with us, that will strengthen her, that will be her comforter. And I pray for everyone here under the sound of my voice, that God will take away your pain. God will bless you and affirm his word concerning your life. May your life never be the same. May he wipe away your tears in the mighty name of Jesus. May the goodness of God that surpasses all understanding be with you all who have gathered here and them that share in this pain with us. May the Lord bless you. May your love for God increase. May you know God and as ever as before, that when all is said and done, you will be proud to be a believer and a child of God. Bless you. Stay blessed. Remain blessed. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. And please don't be in a haste to go. We have refreshment. Let's fellowship a while. And God bless you. And please remember, don't leave here without saying hello to Judy, because she really wants to say hello to you. Thank you very much. We will be meeting. We meet here on Sundays, and we meet from 10:30 to 12:30. You are highly welcome. Thank you very much.
When she came to the Mother's Hospital over 30 years ago, and the first time I saw her, it was like meeting somebody I've been related to all my life. She had a glow about her that just stood out. In if you were in the dark, she would glow, and she was a tremendous friend. She was always there. She never had a bad word to say about anybody. You fell in love with her from the time you see her. And I never thought I'd be here to see this day. I thought I'd go before her. She never moaned or anything. She stuck to everything she did. And she's the wonderfulest friend I've ever had.
I first met Joyce through my friendship with Judy in 2002. And my main friendship was with Judy, but I obviously got to know Joyce because they were such close friends together. And I was able to visit them in their home and always enjoyed their company and their interest in flowers and in animals and their genuine caring for each other and for everybody who was involved in their lives. And it's nice to be here today to remember Joyce and what she's brought, and lovely to hear her life story, which was so complicated, particularly in her early life, but how much she has given to people throughout the life that she has had. It's been an honour to be here.
I just want to thank God for the life of, I called her Auntie Joyce. I must say that she was really always there for me when I needed her. I used to massage her feet sometimes, and that's what I do as part of my profession. And she was so kind and generous to me. We would have chats. Sometimes she would tell me off when I'm massaging her feet. She would give me advice. And really what I always remember about her is, although she was in a little bit of discomfort during the latter years of her life, she always really dedicated herself to God, and she was very enthusiastic, she was very encouraging, and she just loved God so much. But she loved God's people. She especially loved children, and she was just so kind-hearted, and I miss her terribly. Honestly, I miss her so much, but I'm grateful she was in my life. Thank you.
My experiences with Joyce. Judy, all I can say is, Joyce. Okay, can I just say, okay, fair enough, I do have a slight timekeeping problem. No one in my entire life has ever said anything about my timekeeping problem. I show up at yours to see lovely Joyce, and what happens? She lays into me. She actually rips my hide off by going on and on. She did, she actually went on and on and on at me, and poor I was so embarrassed. I just wish the ground would open up. How dare this woman speak to me about my timekeeping? How dare her? But do you know what? I must say, kind of needed it, but she was the only one with enough brawn to say anything to me. So as much as I didn't want to love her, I loved her, but I didn't ever want her to know that I loved her. But she knows that anyway. So I suppose she had the last laugh. I'm now, because of her actually, between me and you, Judy, I'm now actually more on time for a lot of things. So, yeah, thanks, Joyce. Thanks, Joyce, and thanks, Joyce, and thanks, Joyce. And we'll miss her like crazy. But that's it, because I'm not going to cry. Why should I cry? Well, she's like that bird, and she's free. So love you lot. I love you so much. And Judy, you're all right. Not bad for a white chick.
I've known Joyce for about 18 years, approximately, when we first went to St. Peter's Church. Today I heard a lot about Joyce that I'd never ever heard before, or saw a side of Joyce that I'd never seen before. Which was lovely to see. The Joyce I knew was always around her music. She loved Jesus very much, and she was very encouraging at all times. With her missionary work, it was lovely. My husband and I do short-term missions abroad, so we always had lots to talk about. But it was really lovely to see Judy's thoughts on Joyce, because it showed a side of Joyce that I'd never heard. The fun side, the loving side, and it was really lovely. So I've been a pleasure to be here today, and I know she's happy in the Lord.
In the mid-90s, we went a few times, late 90s, we went a few times to open meetings, and the first impression I had of Joyce was her infectious faith and love, which permeated through the church, and it warmed your soul. You knew that there was a person who really loved God, and there was a real sense of security and trust there. And later on, we actually, just a few years ago, we started going to the Oasis regularly, and my opinion of her was still the same, that she just had that tremendous faith in God and was an encourager of fellow believers. And you knew that there was a person who would be a friend for life, and she would never let you down. And she was just greatly loved and revered by, as we have seen today, by everybody with whom she came into contact.
Hello, I'm Alison Kitchener, and I'm the Baptist minister from the Newington Free Church round the corner. And I know Judy because she came to our church to use the baptistry pool. But also many years ago, she came to Queen's Road Baptist Church, which is where I was. And also my husband was her doctor, so he remembers her very well. So it's lovely to have been able to be here this afternoon and just give thanks for who she was and what she did and how much we've learned this afternoon. Praise God for Joyce.
It's a privilege to be able to say something about Joyce. For 3.5 years I helped to look after the little church at St. Peter's where she and Judy were members. They were very good to me, very kind to me, showed me hospitality on many occasions. And they used to make me laugh, I used to make them laugh. They particularly enjoyed some of the words I used in my preaching. One of their favourites was sesquipedalian, which means words that are 1.5 feet long. I also remember talking about the blandishments of the devil, and that set them giggling. But they'll tell you that they absolutely enjoyed being part of all of that in that place. They've been great people. We're grateful that Judy is still around. It will seem strange when you can't say Judy and Joyce or Joyce and Judy. In fact, I think the only other name you might associate with Judy is Punch, and Joyce makes a far better accompaniment. Bless you both.
My first experience seeing Joyce was at the Elam Church in St. Peter's. I had I basically came to the church as a new person, joined the youth club, and she was part of the group of people that showed me such love, such care, such attention, and was such a blessing in that, and encouraged me and allowed me to play the keyboard in church alongside her, even though I wasn't very good yet. And I just increased and grew from there. Yeah, she was always very generous. She always insisted on paying for meals. In fact, you were doing her a great dishonour if you even tried to pay. So generous to a fault. She would always provide for anybody with any financial difficulty. She would just be there with cash in hand just to help. That's pretty incredible.
My name's Dino, and I lived with Joyce and Judy for approximately 2 years. Joyce and Judy introduced me to Oasis Church, and they supported me through difficult times, very, very difficult times, and I grew to love Joyce and Judy very dearly. We had a lot of fantastic times together. We shared the same interest in nature and the Bible, and I'm so sorry that Joyce isn't with us anymore, but she's in a better place, and I thank the Lord for watching over us and for bringing us together to enable us to know each other.
Hi, my name's Sarah. I'm a member of Global Crossfire Church. I haven't been coming to the church for very long, so I haven't known Joyce for that long, but I wish I had, because from the time I've known her, she's shown herself to be an amazing person with such a kind heart, and she helped me a lot with my daughter, who's 17 months now. She had some feeding problems and some issues with a health visitor, and she was really there for me, and I really appreciated her help and her kindness. And I can smile now because I know for certain that she's definitely in heaven, and I hope one day we'll all see her again. And yeah, God bless Joyce. She was a lovely person.
Well, what can I say? Joyce was a blessing for everyone around her. She was an amazing person, and for the little time that I knew her, she was like a spiritual mother to me. And yeah, maybe she didn't have own kids, but I can say that I was her spiritual son. She was just a huge blessing, not just for me, for everyone who knew her. And I'm just grateful that I had the chance and God gave me the chance to know her. So I hope to see her one day in heaven.
I was lucky enough to have met Joyce while at Elim Church. It was actually the church that I became a Christian at, and she was a huge, huge part of sort of part of that experience. She's always been there for us, she's always supported us, and it was a great privilege to have known her and to have been a small part at least of her life, and she's going to be greatly missed by all of us.
Sister Joyce, as a friend, was very loyal, very inspiring, very interesting. She's led a very interesting life, and some of the stories that she told me about Sierra Leone, I can relate to, because I spent some years there myself, and we had some good discussions about Sierra Leone, and she loved Sierra Leone, and but I found her an inspiration, a person, the way she dealt with illnesses, operations and so forth. She inspired me to rise above pain and sorrow. She's really showed you how to live your life, and yeah, she was a very good person.
Hi Judy, we'd just love to say how much we love Joyce and how much a big part she played in everyone's lives. She was loved by so many people, and she's going to be missed so dearly, but now she's at rest in a better place and she'll be happy.
I met with Deaconess Joyce in this church 3 years ago. She's a very lovely woman, a great woman of God. She's very caring. She's lovely. She always smiles, and she loves God. She always advises us, the young one, to be very careful in our spiritual life. So we're going to miss her a lot. She means a lot to us.
Auntie Joyce is very good.
and Auntie Judy loves everyone. And I love her. And I love Auntie Judy and Auntie Joyce. And she was kind to me. I would never forget her.
This child.
May God bless you. Goodbye. I loved Auntie Joyce. She used to come to church. And I used to go to her house, and I really loved her, and I would never forget her. And I really, really miss her, and I would never forget her.